meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I have received apologies from Stephanie Callaghan for today's meeting, and James Dornan is substituting and is joining us remotely. The first item on our agenda this morning is to choose a new convener. The procedure is explained in the choice of convener paper, which is paper one for this meeting. The Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish National Party are eligible for nomination as convener of this committee, and I would invite members of that party to nominate one of their number for this post. Emma Harper.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. And I propose Claire Hawkey as convener.
Thank you very much. Do we agree to choose Claire Hawkey as our convener? We are then agreed. So can I firstly congratulate Claire Hawkey on her appointment as convener of this committee. I'm going to vacate the chair now and pass over to Claire. So in order to make that as seamless as possible, if we can just suspend briefly, that would be very helpful.
Thank you. So the second item on our agenda today are decisions whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. We now move to the fifth evidence session as part of our inquiry into female participation in sport and physical activity. This session will focus on coverage and representation of women and girls sport by the media. We have a number of witnesses with us today. We have Bobby Hain, Managing Director of Broadcasting at STV, Catherine Houlihan, Managing Editor at ITV Borders, John McClellan, Director of Scottish Newspaper Society, Margaret Mary Murray, Head of Commissioning at BBC Gaelic Digital Services and Inclusion, Catherine Salmond, Editor of The Herald, and Louise Thornton, Head of Commissioning at BBC Scotland. So welcome to you all this morning. We're going to move straight to questions. And if I could perhaps start with you, is women's sport seen as second class or second best in sports, women's sports journalism? And if so, how can this perception be changed? Who wants to start with that one? Thanks, Louise.
So, first of all, I would say absolutely not, certainly not in the BBC. We bring our level of professionalism to all of our broadcast coverage. But what I would say is, you know, we are on a journey. You know, we're the biggest media provider in the UK. We provide free-to-air access. We bring audiences together around about our big sporting moments, and that's across men and women's sport. And with that, really, we can draw big audiences and help sports to grow. And I think we've seen, you know, certainly over the past decade, how women's sport has grown and flourished. And I think a lot of that is to do with the fact that we can offer that big moment free-to-air coverage. But I think, you know, our lessons as the BBC is obviously round about the importance of that free-to-air, the importance of having a listed system that's, you know, future fit as well, being able to have long-term commitment in terms of sport, sort of dipping in and out of things is less preferable, to be able to commit to coverage and to growing an audience for certain sports. And I think the final part of that is working in partnership. You know, our licence fee is frozen, and we're seeing a real-term cut in 30% in our income. Obviously, with the growth and success of sports comes an increased commercial cost for rights. So, you know, in some ways you can be a victim of your own success in that. And so the commitment that we have to sport and women's sport is absolute for audiences, but to deliver it effectively, you know, we really do need to work in partnership to do this.
Anyone else?
Yes, I suppose I'd like to pick up on Louise's point. Ciar mila taig gaivarson in Codam Hortgain, if we bring a sleigh, Sheridan Gaelic. Many, many thanks, convener and members of the committee, to enabling us to offer evidence. I look after the BBC's Gaelic language services, and since the inception of BBC Alapa in 2008, BBC Alapa has been committed to growing women's sport across the three strategic sports that we deliver, women's football, women's rugby and shinty. And we're delighted just to learn earlier this year that Kirsty Loughran has been appointed as the Camnock Association's first female development officer. So we've been on that journey since 2008, and as Louise says, it requires commitment. It requires a strategic approach, and it requires resourcing, and that means, you know, ensuring that we have adequate funding for production, because, you know, as part of the mix, you have sporting rights, but also you have that commitment to production, and ensuring again within production that the production values that we bring to the coverage of women's sport are as good and as professional as we offer for any sport. So we've been on that journey since 2008, and I think we've seen the profile of women's sport grow in that time. But as Louise says, we are on a journey.
And in terms of the print media, I don't suppose we often see women's sport on the back pages.
I think it's easy to see coverage of sport in general through the prism of football. And you could just as easily say that you don't see many sports other than football on the back pages. So if you go back over time, I don't think there's any question that women's football was very much second-class citizen to the men's game. And the growth of women's football has shone a light on all forms of female sport. But if you look at other sports, then I don't think that female participation has been in any way seen as a second class at all. Athletics, tennis, and, you know, to name only two. So it does depend on what sport you're talking about. But I mean, I think in general terms, to answer a very broad question, no, women's sport has never been seen as a second class activity compared to the men. And when women do well, they get the same billing as the men do, as, you know, many medal winners have shown.
So is it that other sports are second class in comparison to
football? Well, as a rugby supporter, then the times that rugby gets on the back pages compared to football are relatively small. So I think that over many years, you know, in all forms of sports coverage, be it press or broadcast, football has been the dominant thing, and men's football has dominated. I mean, obviously, as you probably know, to the extent that women's football was illegal in England. So the whole debate has changed because of the parity that women's football and women's rugby is now achieving.
Can I jump in there on the print side of things? So obviously I'm editor of the Herald. The newspaper industry in itself has changed dramatically, probably in tandem with the coverage of women in sport. You know, we are now a digital first operation. So for us to justify the amount of exposure that women's sporting events need to get to be able to grow is really difficult for us, because it doesn't work for our model. There isn't the audience there at the moment, whether you're looking at a page view model for newspapers or a digital subscription model, which is what the Herald is looking at. There simply isn't the audience there at the moment for us to justify the volume of attention that we give to other sports, which are unfortunately in this setting male dominated. So for that exposure to grow, to allow the sporting, you know, world of, you know, female, you know, events to grow, we need a sustainable financial model. We are, you know, completely and utterly measured on metrics, and the metrics do not add up. You know, if I was to throw everything I had into covering female sports, it still wouldn't yield the financial returns for our business model. So what would help would be a robust financial situation similar to the local democracy reporting scheme that we have in Scotland, some sort of support from the government to fund reporters that cover female sports, to allow the exposure to grow, to give us a situation where we would be in a properly commercially viable situation.
Thank you. I believe Paul Sweeney wants to come in on this thing.
Yeah, I just thought it was a really interesting insight. Thank you very much, Convener, for calling me. I just wanted to follow up on that. What active measures do you take to monitor engagement, and what, have you developed any trends over time? It would be interesting to contrast maybe the print with broadcasting, and that interesting idea that maybe if you were to front-load coverage through the public service broadcasting model, that would then cascade into the commercial and print media in particular.
For us, our analytics are live. You know, we have our live dashboard there telling us exactly how long people are spending on stories, how many people are reading them, how many people are choosing to subscribe to a story based on, you know, which one they read. So it's there. And for us, the yield on female sports is really, really, really low.
Hmm. And in terms of the broadcasting, have you seen any sort of evolution in sort of engagement and coverage over time that might, in the longer term, perhaps present an opportunity for print media?
Yes, absolutely, is the short answer. When I took this job, one of my priorities was to work in partnership with my colleague, Margaret Mary Murray, and to build on the great work the BBC Alba have done with the Women's Game for Football. BBC Alba, Margaret Mary can talk to this, but the investment has come from BBC Alba over many years. But in terms of the audience and the audience interest that our audience data team can measure for us, we could see the interest in women's football increasing significantly. So over the past 2 years, we've invested in a joint collaboration with BBC Alba. So just for example, in the first year, in 2021, we covered 10 programmes for women's football. And then last year we covered 43, and then we've seen our metrics increase fourfold for that. And then when we look at that in line with the international coverage and the coverage of the Lionesses, we can see there's a huge market for women's football, and covering it all under our Sports Scene brand has been really successful for us. So running a highlights programme, providing red button English language commentary when BBC Alba have the live games. And then also BBC Scotland is going to stream up to 26 games on iPlayer as well, because for us, perhaps similar to Catherine, the investment in digital and the growth in, you know, audiences consuming multi-platform content, that's really where we're seeing a growth audience.
That's interesting. Is there an experience with STV and ITV? Have you had a similar experience?
Yes, I think we would add to the original question too, to say that we certainly don't see our coverage and reporting of sport, of women's sport, as in any way second rate to to men's sports. I would make three points briefly. First of all, on coverage, I think for us, our model is slightly different. We are not in the business of acquiring rights and making productions. Our operation is an opt-out basis. So we have a UK network of which we are part, and our programming obligations are largely around news and current affairs, which is the first point to make. I think the second point is around variety of sport across the board. And I think that in making sure that we are reflecting activities beyond football, and ensuring that we are reflecting the profile of our society, we have very consciously and deliberately targeted better representation over the last few years. So, for example, for 2023, for our news programmes, we are targeting a gender balance among contributors and also a profile of ethnically diverse contributors, which in the case of the ethnic minorities would be 12%, which is higher than the previously published census data in anticipation of new data coming later this year. And then the final point to make is the contribution that broadcasters and other areas can make to reporting, because I think that's a really important point too. It's about seeing inspiring women athletes, women players and the women's games on TV and the reporting of that. But I think it's also important to recognise that we need a mix of people making the reports. And I think STV, we have a long tradition of encouraging and nurturing female talent behind the scenes and on screen in order to do so.
Thanks, yeah,
and I would add to that for ITV Border, which covers the Scottish Borders and Dumfries and Galloway, the landscape there is slightly different for sport. So rugby is a dominating sport, and ice hockey and curling. So we tend to be driven by where there's action on television, and the women's sport is absolutely on a par with male, if not, you know, for example, the curlers would get top billing on our programme as opposed to, you know, perhaps lower league male football. So the answer is no, it's not lesser than male sport, but we're restricted to what we can actually broadcast. We can't send cameras to every sporting event across the region. That's not our model. So the sports that are actually broadcast under the Sports News Atlas deal, the more there is, we would be happy to show it.
Emma Harper.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener. Just to pick up on what Catherine is saying about ITV Border, because, you know, I am a Stranraer lass, I live in Dumfries now. ITV Border is our go-to for curling and for the Solway Sharks ladies team. So I'm interested, if you track the data that Catherine Salmon is talking about as far as digital access online, because you're right, we do have difference in, like, rugby is just massive in Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish Borders for women and men, and again, just to the ice hockey is another one, and the curling. So is that something that you monitor, the tracking of what people are watching then on the telly?
No, we don't specifically monitor track in terms of, you know, a breakdown by sport or even gender. All we monitor is gender balance across the output of ITV Border News. So gender balance and other diversity measurements like disability and age and so on. But not the individual performance of individual sports, no.
Okay.
Thanks, Convener. Sorry, I didn't hear you there. Yes, I wanted to ask Louise about a point you had made, and it kind of also relates to what Margaret Mary said. In evidence last week, some of the witnesses were very supportive of your work and said that you had great coverage, which was amazing. And obviously you've got this collaboration going on. And Louise, you had made the comment that, you know, you've got a lot of output going out just now, but the numbers have increased of who is watching. Is that the key here? If the output is going out, are more people going to watch? And maybe Louise or Margaret Mary can come in.
I think we have seen over the last 10, 12 years both audiences and crowds growing. You know, we saw just recently two national team games being played to really big crowds. So I think the coverage across the media, on television, on radio, and streaming services, really helps to raise the profile and, I suppose, create stars of the future. We saw Emma Watson score her first goals for Scotland, and you know she will be a household name from now on. So it's being on that on the journey that through the exposure on the media you ensure that audiences become accustomed to seeing women's sport across the schedule as something that is normal, as something that is regular, and as something that is incredibly entertaining, because the athletes and the sports people involved are at the top of their game, and it is a brilliant watch. So that in itself creates a momentum and an attraction, both for people to watch the sport in person, but also to join into to the media coverage.
Thank you. So we're going to move on a little bit and pick up, I guess, on a little bit of what Bobby Hayne was talking about there about broadcasting and reporting and the roles within that. So I'm going to move to Tess White to start off.
Thank you, Convener. My question is to Catherine Salmon, if I may, Catherine. So women are severely underrepresented in sports journalism. So only 3% of staff jobs on sports desks on Scottish print titles are filled by women. So, in your opinion, what barriers face women accessing the sports desks, and what, in your opinion, could the industry do to overcome those barriers?
Okay, in my opinion, I think things are changing. When I think of how things were when I started in the industry, for example, I'm the first female editor in 239 years at the Herald, so that's maybe an indication of how things are changing. Sports desks were, and John will vouch for this, pretty much all men, and very much a masculine culture that probably mirrors some of the audience spectating culture within particularly football. Things are definitely changing behind the scenes. We have more pleasant newsrooms in that respect. So I am confident that that has taken time, but we are moving forward and the change is visible. For women, we have a problem here that when we advertise for sports jobs, and this has been pretty much the whole time that I've been a journalist, very few women apply for sports reporting jobs. In my previous employer, we were linked with weekly newspapers in England where they ran journalism apprenticeship schemes, and they brought young journalists in and gave them exposure to all aspects of the newsroom. Very, very few female, you know, want-to-be reporters ever wanted to go onto the sports desk. So it's something that has fascinated me, and I don't have the answer. To me, the barriers in my newsroom and my sports team are not there. I have an incredibly enthusiastic head of sport who is desperate for more women and is actively trying to seek them out, but they're not coming. So I don't think there are barriers. I think there may have been in the past, but they're definitely not there now. But there doesn't seem to be a huge appetite for young reporters to want to join the sports teams in an online print setting at the moment.
Great. John?
Thank you. I'll take a step before that, I think, because I'm going to put my other hat on as a lecturer in journalism at Stirling University. I've been running final year projects and helping with our employability agenda throughout that time, and what I see as the cohort comes through, and we've got probably about 80 going into the final year now. We do one-to-one conversations with the young student journalists about what they're going to do in their final year and what their eventual career goals will be. I could definitely count on the fingers of one hand, if that, the amount of female students who say they want to go into sports journalism. And I don't have to ask at the beginning of a year to know that the vast majority of the blokes will say, I'd like to go into sport, particularly football, and very, very few, if any, of the female students will say, I'm interested in sports journalism. Now, that may change over time with higher exposure and things like women's football on television. But as it stands, the new entrants going through universities, the young female students aren't interested in doing sport. Top of the female students lists are usually social subjects, mental health issues, society stuff, and a bit of arts, but not sport. And this year at our offer holders open day, for the first time, a young woman said to me that she was interested in sports journalism, and I said, hooray, great. I said, you will go all the way because you're needed and you're wanted. But she's an exception.
Kamina, before my second question, there is a Women in Journalism research project that actually challenges that premise that you've just stated, that women students actually do get pushback from lecturers. So just wondered if you were familiar with that piece of work.
I'm certainly not familiar with the claim of lecturers pushing back at female students not to do sport. I mean, that would be quite the opposite. You know, certainly if I put my old hat back on as an editor, I would have been only too delighted to be able to bring a variety to the sports desk, because it would change the dynamic and change the kind of coverage. But I haven't seen that research in depth, but it certainly is not the case at Stirling at all.
And my second question actually to John as well, John. So sports presenter Ali Barber tweeted last year following misogynistic jokes at the Scottish Footballers Writers Association Awards ceremony that she'd never felt so unwelcome in the industry I work in. So in your opinion, what specific challenges are faced by women in sports journalism?
Perhaps Catherine's in a better position to answer that. I suppose that from what Catherine said, and it's true that sports desks are dominated by men in print. That's still the case, and you know your figures aren't that far wide of the mark. So from the point of view of somebody who's already in the industry and looking across the room and saying, well, where do I want to go next? Then perhaps seeing a phalanx of blokes means that that's less of an attractive place. That apart, as Catherine says, there are no barriers. And from a senior point of view, then the more women that can involve themselves in sports coverage, the better. You may have seen the kind of material that Heather Dewar has been producing for the Scottish Daily Mail recently. That's added something completely new to their sports coverage, and in fact has added a significant level of public interest to what's happening inside one of our major sports. And you know, and that's a great thing.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tess. Emma Harper.
Thank you. Just to pick up on what Tess White is saying, is, you know, I see there's women who are pundits on the telly. They're post, maybe they were professional footballers or rugby. Or is there an opportunity for people who have played sport, whether it's professional or not, to enter into a career of journalism? How would they go about that as far as needing a degree, needing the stages? Is it college, university, postgrad? What are the opportunities for women who have maybe retired from professional sport to maybe become journalists? I'm looking at Margaret Mary, because you're nodding.
Yeah. I think there are huge opportunities, and I guess across all of this is you know, the adage, you can't be what you can't see, whether that's in print or in broadcast. You know, ensuring that we give platforms to women journalists, broadcasters, pundits, analysts, commentators, as well as the players. And I think across BBC Scotland's portfolio in Gaelic and in English, we have seen a number of former athletes, players, become pundits, analysts and journalists. And as far as I know, I don't think you need any formal qualification other than being brilliant at what you do and being recognised as being brilliant at what you do. I don't know, Louise, do you want to...?
I think if Tom Connor, our sports editor, was in this chair, you know, he would have, you know, numerous examples of how he and his team have developed female talent. I mean, I could list Amy Irons, Leanne Crichton, you know the names that we have coming through. And what we don't do is just drop somebody into a situation and expect them to be the full package. There's periods of training and development, but our absolute aim is that we have 50-50 representation on our programming. We achieve that in sports scene results. We would like to get that across all our programming and our commentary. And the way to do that is to develop and grow and invest in the talent. It's clearly there, as Margaret Mary says, but you need to invest and you need to support all the way through.
With broadcasting, as with anything, the more you do it, the better you become. And as Louise was saying, with that support across teams, you gain confidence, and we see again in this spirit of partnership, Gaelic speaking reporters and presenters working across Gaelic language services and English language services. People like Iona Ballantyne, who presents a magazine programme for BBC Alapa, also reports for Radio Scotland and for our digital services on BBC Scotland.
I might add, if I may, a mention of the programme Expert Voices, which STV has developed, which is an outreach programme encouraging people who have not been contributors for one reason or another on media but are somehow experts in their field. And this is a programme that applies across all aspects of life, and we will target a sports-specific version of what we do. These are sessions held typically 20 or 30 people at a time, where we encourage people to understand what it means to be on TV, and to give them some training and coaching and, importantly, confidence from people who've been on that journey, for example. So Maria Lyle, the Paralympian, took part in a recent session on people with disabilities being on TV, and that was a very successful session. We've had over 700 people come through those sessions in the past year or two, and around 100 of them have appeared on STV programmes, either news or our current affairs programmes. And to help encourage more players and coaches and people involved in the game, people who work with some of the sporting bodies, for example, the public service, people who make podcasts but aren't on TV yet because they're in audio only, that is an audience that we are reaching out to encourage more people to feel confident and empowered to talk about what they love and what they're passionate about through Expert Voices.
Thanks. I'm going to move to Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. We mentioned earlier that that perception of the sports desks and that they're male-dominated, and the previous sort of culture within them, I think I'll probably come to Catherine on this. Do you believe that's potentially a perception that we need to continue to challenge, to make women who are coming through university degrees and other places that actually this is somewhere that they can come to work, if that is indeed something that is playing on their mind? And do you think that there's a link between women's sport representation in printing and on the TV and on the radio and things, and the number of women who are coming to work in sports journalism? And as Margaret Mary said, that if you can't see it, you can't be it side of things.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the perception is now. I would like to think social media has changed an awful lot, again, since I started as a journalist, when there wasn't social media. And you did go into newsrooms, whether it was as work experience as a student. Yeah, the men were on the news desks, and yeah, they were quite gruff. And they could be quite, I don't know, dismissive of a young female reporter. I've been on the receiving end of that, but that's fine. I think it's really important now for the visibility to inspire and to show change. So I do think social media helps. We might come on to where it doesn't help, but it definitely does help. John mentioned there Heather Dewar. You've mentioned countless other prominent female sports journalists. It does influence change there. We try hard, and we are trying harder to work with universities and to try to get people in. And I've been at events with John where I've spoken about things to students. I think that is mirrored across the Scottish print and online offering that the newsrooms I know would all be like that, desperate for the best talent, whether that's male or female. If there are aspiring female sports journalists out there, they are definitely, I think, given the perception that we are approachable. I don't know if that was the case years ago.
I think I remember that Glasgow University incident. I remember at the time that Moira Gordon was quoted extensively after that, and Moira was very, very clear that she had never encountered bad behaviour in all the times that she had worked at Scotsman Publications. Now, she was only one woman on the sports desk, and certainly my recollection of my time there was that there was no poor culture amongst the sports teams there, either the Evening News or the Scotsman. And I think that the senior sports staff would have been and would still be horrified if they were being accused of encouraging some kind of macho culture in which a woman felt uncomfortable, because the woman who was in the middle of it all did not feel uncomfortable, and they were honourable, decent people working with the people who were there. And if we could have got more people who were keen to join Moira, then that would have been to our advantage, not disadvantage.
I think it is clear, you know, a gruff macho culture doesn't mean being mean to women and putting them off. You know, a lot of, you know, people can, a lot of women can hold their own quite comfortably among gruff macho men. It doesn't mean that they can't see themselves being able to have a job there. So I really do think that needs to be established, you know, that the idea that there's some weak, you know, female tradie journalists out there thinking, oh, I'd love to join there, but oh God, I'm scared of all them, those men. I just don't think that happens. I really don't. But you know, John's got direct access to students, you know, if they're feeling like that. But women can hold their own among a group of men talking about football.
Absolutely, or any other issue for that matter, given the number of gruff journalists I'm sure we all deal with every week. Not to put any. Oh. Someone's gonna tweet about that, aren't they? To move on to a slightly different topic. I couldn't possibly comment. I'm interested in how we also address additional challenges that women may face coming into journalism, whether they be from a minority ethnic background, for any form of disability, for members of an LGBTQ plus community. For example, I was speaking to a friend of mine who considered sports journalism before they went on to do something else at university, and they also have a hearing loss. And going into a lot of sports punditry, that impairment put them off going into that side of things. What do your organisations do to encourage people from a diverse range of backgrounds to consider taking up a career in sports journalism, and how can you continue to support them through that journey as well? Louise is looking at me. So.
First of all, it's hugely important, isn't it? It's important for every single organisation that, first of all, we have an inclusive culture and we have an inclusive recruitment policy. So I think those are two things. And then the other part of what we do in our organisation is about challenging stereotypes and in our output. So, you know, you can't be if you can't see it, then we must make sure that our output across all our platforms looks and feels like the audience. And so we need to make sure that, you know, the culture of our organisation, whenever you come in to the BBC, I've had somebody start yesterday, and the first thing we do is we try and make sure that feels welcoming. We understand, well, we'll have already understood if there are any accessibility needs or any adjustments that we need to make, and that will have been done right at the start. But in terms of how we recruit, and perhaps Margaret Mary as inclusion lead can speak to it more effectively than I can, but it's absolutely about it comes right back down to the way you look for people, the way you write your job advertisement, the way you hold your interview panel, what does your interview panel look like? So we think about all those things at every stage, because it's crucially important that we get a really healthy mix of people in the decision-making teams and the production teams, and also, you know, on the airwaves as well, to really represent our audience.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have too much to add to that, you know, other than, you know, for everybody, inclusion and the culture of the workplace is absolutely critical. You know, we're speaking about, you know, gruffness in journalism, but, you know, we should, as organisations, ensure that at whatever level you're working, or at whatever stage in your career you might be, that you're working in a supportive and inclusive environment within the workplace. As Louise was saying, you know, we have to ensure that our output and our workforce reflect the diversity of the population. You know, the BBC has published targets that we're working very hard to meet and ensure that that our workplace and our output is as representative as possible.
I would agree, and I think NCB, not just in sport but across all jobs, we just want the best candidate, and once you have the best candidate, then it's how we can accommodate and you know, enable them to work to their best ability.
I think one thing I might add is I've talked about STV's inclusion and diversity targets and the journey that we've been on, and the targeting that we have, which is not just for our on-air representation but also the profile of our colleagues around the country, and that has seen real progress, because I think it's one of those areas where you have to have a sense of what you're doing, and you have to know and people have to understand what you stand for, your values need to be clear. But actually having some form of target that's calibrated and clear and transparent is very helpful, because it's a very strong focal point. But the other thing I would say is that, and perhaps it's a function of television newsrooms, which is we absolutely encourage our journalists who are not dedicated sports journalists to do sports stories as well, where they have an interest. So I'm thinking of Ivana Holland in our Edinburgh newsroom, who's a very sports-interested journalist, but is a general journalist, but will cover sports. Selena Jackson, who's just joined us in the Glasgow newsroom, she had a piece on the footballing sisters, Brogan and Cody Hay, who were in the Scottish Cup action on the lead-up to the Scottish Cup semis in the last couple of weeks. So I think there is not just dedicated sports journalism as a way to reflect your interest in the subject, but opportunities for people around the country who do have an interest in sport also to be reporting on it.
I've got time for another...
No.
OK, that's fine. Thanks, Convener.
Follow Kane.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I suppose my question is quite a direct question, reflecting on something that Catherine Salmond had suggested, I think, in her opening contribution around modelling potentially around the Local Democracy Reporter Network. Now, I think as politicians, we find that network very helpful very often if we want to tell a story. Not so often if we're trying to avoid a story, right enough. But, you know, in terms of your vision of how that might work, would that be about, do you think, trying to really target and focus that into recruiting more women into journalism, and then I suppose really drilling that down into a local level like the Democracy Network, and ensuring that we can cover actually those grassroots sporting clubs and events and those sorts of things?
Yeah, I think it's twofold, isn't it? It's do you want to encourage more female reporters, or do you want to increase the coverage of female sport? Because there is something that sticks in the throat of a lot of sports reporters, women, who are told women should cover women's sports, and they, you know. So if it is a case for me of increasing exposure to women's sports, and we just need the best journalists to do that, it would be brilliant, you know, at the same time if we could grow our female reporting numbers while we grow our exposure and coverage of female sports. But you know, the two are not. It's not women for women's sports. So for me, it would be let's increase the audiences that are engaged meaningfully with with women's sports. So yeah, you basically fund or part fund a model where reporters are focusing on these sports that really need to grow to survive, really. But as I say, we just don't have the audiences there at the moment, and our metrics are live. Yeah. They are to the minute.
And am I correct in saying that the Local Democracy Network was partly funded through the licence fee of through the BBC charter?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so there may well be models for government to consider, whether at reserved or devolved level, in terms of how we might do some of this.
I think there's genuine collaboration and a willingness at the moment to do this, definitely within my newsroom. You know, I feel sorry for all these old stuffy men that we're talking about in the past, because I'm not really sure who they were. You know, there were a few, but sports desks have always been really passionate places. They have to be. You know, the hours that reporters put into, particularly anti-social hours, to covering sport is phenomenal. And my team at the moment is a really forward-thinking, digitally focused mixture of young, old, fresh, gruff, whatever you want to call them, but they just really want to see those sports audiences grow and for the future of Scottish journalism to be clear in our digital model. So anything that is an idea that could be formulated would definitely get our support.
Very good. I'm
just going to move on to Sandesh Gulhani, who's got a brief supplementary on this theme. After Mr. Gulhani, if it's
Thank you, convener. I have just the one question, and I direct it to Louise Thornton, if I may. One of the things that we heard last week was about top female athletes in sports which aren't normally very well represented. So judo, for example, mountain biking, sports that are very big at the Olympics. But these ladies are not household names. Because we don't seem to be covering. So Trans World Sport, for example, for when I was a kid, everyone around my age knows kabaddi, but it's not exactly a mainstream sport, but it's because it was covered. So do you have any, are you looking at all to try to use your position as a BBC to cover a sports package where we can see women excelling from this country, for example, in sports like judo throughout the year, so it's not just one big bang at the Olympics?
Thank you for the question. And the short answer is absolutely. I have the privilege of being able to commission across all the platforms. So I commission across BBC One, BBC Scotland Channel, but also into iPlayer, Radio Scotland Sounds, and onto our digital and social platforms. So apart from what you might see around about the big moments on television that we all come together for, we have a significant amount of budget pointed at what we do on Sport Online. And Sport Online is a huge platform for us. Just for the Scotland part of Sport Online, we attract about 2 million viewers a week for that. That's not insignificant numbers. So with the budget we have allocated specifically to that, that allows us to do exactly what you're saying. So we've invested in streaming netball. We covered the judo win, actually. We did do that on our digital platforms. We've covered gymnastics. We've covered female boxing. So this is where we use the ability that we have with those platforms to do things that we might not be able to schedule on television, or we might see an opportunity for a sport that we think there's a particular interest in. But unlike football, which happens all throughout the year and you can build a habit for, some sports just happen at sort of certain times throughout the year. So that's our approach there. And we've got a whole list of sports that we do cover on that platform. And alongside that, what we try and do is also identify talent and really tell the stories of particular talent. So if we were to take some top Scottish athletes leading up to the Commonwealth Games, we would not just invest in the coverage on television, we would actually be, you know, going to training camps and following their stories there. We've been following Hannah Rankin, who's a young boxer, maybe not you know, a household name at the moment, but hopefully a household name for Scotland in the future. So that's where we think we can really add value, and then that allows us also to sort of work out where to put
the investment for women's sport when we really see audiences come through and we have a success with something. Women's curling is a great example. You know, we stream women's curling and we do lots of digital coverage round about that. But netball, I think, is a really interesting example. We've had some success with streaming netball, so that's something we would look to doing more of in future.
Thank you. So we'll move on to our next theme, and I'm going to ask Evelyn Frame to ask the first question, please.
Thanks, Convener. Female pundits can often get a lot of criticism and horrific backlash to the way they've presented, said, whatever. If that happens, how do you support them and what do you have in place to protect them? And I'd like to ask Louise.
Thank you. Yes, it's particularly social media can be a very misogynistic place, can't it? And some platforms more than others. So first of all, we've got absolute duty of care to our staff, like any organisation. But you know, we are particularly aware that when women are on social media, they're subject to things that men just simply aren't. And certainly I've had that experience myself. I used to run a platform called The Social, and any time a woman posted a piece of content, we would be on standby. Now, that is exactly the same that we do for our top talent. Doesn't matter what level in the organisation you're at. If you're a person who's posting on social media, our editors have duty of care with that person. So first of all, there's a conversation round about what anyone's going to post and what potential ramifications there could be. But we also monitor, obviously, we monitor our output, and we take action. We will block people, we will ban people, we will take people from our platforms if they've broken social media guidelines. We were part of a campaign, I just must get the name right, Hate Won't Win, which was all about supporting female talent in the sports world. That was in partnership with Sky. It's sad that we have to do this, but it's just a matter of fact. And I think to Catherine's point, you know, these people are professionals and they're aware of the environment in which they operate. But we're all human beings, and it can be incredibly hurtful, some things people post on social media, so we take every action to support them on a human level, but as an organisation to really monitor and make sure we take action on our accounts if there are hateful comments.
Okay, thank you. Does anyone else want to come in? No? Yeah. Okay, thank you. The Council of Europe's report on gender equality in sport and the role of the media found that female athletes are often portrayed in a stereotyped, comical, sexualised and sexist manner in the media, and noted that this portrayal impacts negatively, obviously, on female participation in sport. What guidelines do you have in place to prevent this from happening, and what processes are there if it does happen? And to, again, anyone would like to come in on that. What guidelines are in place?
I think I would start by saying I don't recognise that description of our output, in all honesty, and we obviously take feedback and analysis very carefully, particularly of specific Scottish output, ours or anyone else's. I think I would say naturally we have the Ofcom code, which is a very detailed set of responsibilities that applies to broadcasters generally, public service broadcasters in particularly. We have a sense of impartiality and fairness, which stems from the code, but goes to our values over 60 plus years now as STV. And I think when I think of the examples of supporting the promotion of sports and individuals, young upcoming athletes, for example, Katie Shanahan, who is a double bronze winning swimmer in the Birmingham Commonwealth Games on her way to the Olympics, hopefully. We ran a feature on her in the last couple of weeks. Chloe Grant, who is the first young woman to be inducted into the all-woman Formula One Academy, and other similar stories just in the last few weeks. I think they're generally very fair, absolutely appropriate, and don't suffer from any of those allegations that you've described. So I think we have a real sense of who we are and who we talk to and who our audience are. And as STV, with the biggest news audience on a night, up to 500,000 people watching, we've got a really big responsibility to all of the people in that programme and also to our audience to be fair and reasonable and accurate in the way that we support and promote the stories that we do.
I would agree with that, speaking for ITV Border. The whole programming is all about celebrating the region, celebrating success and celebrating, you know, individuals. So any time there's, and we do feature an awful lot of female sports achievers, both in disability sports and in able-bodied sports. So they're on a par with men, and there's absolutely no mocking or second-class status. It's a given that they're treated properly.
Can I ask, do you ever get it wrong? I take your point, Bobby, you're not in tune or not in line with the characterisation of that report, but do you ever get it wrong? Do the public ever say to you, you've got this wrong, not happy with this, and how do you deal with that? To anyone?
I don't think that we get it wrong in the way that you're describing. I'm not familiar with any complaint along those lines. We do come in for criticism, particularly for, usually from fans of one side or another, in very established sports. And those are partisan supporters. They're very passionate about what they do. And, you know, depending on your view, you might think our reporting is, you know, is either biased in one way or another. Mm-hmm. But I think that's quite a different arena from the kind of allegations you're talking about in terms of fairness or a sense of common courtesy and reasonableness in how we deal with people and how we present people. That is not an allegation I've seen levied against what we do.
I would echo Bobby's point. I think, you know, as we've mentioned, unfortunately some people, some fans, football fans, sports fans, general audience members, do still hold misogynistic views and will tweet or contact the BBC to express those misogynistic views. But everybody that we work with, that we put on the air, that we put on our programmes, that we feature, are absolute examples of excellence of women in sport. And we bring the same level of broadcast professionalism to the women's sport as we do the men's sport. So I don't recognise the stereotype that you're talking about, because that's everything that we are trying to dispel. Of course, we adhere to our editorial guidelines, but our overarching mission with sport in general, and particularly women's sport, is to celebrate, is to challenge those stereotypes, and is also to promote an open conversation about the issues that you are talking about.
Very, very brief.
Microphone, thanks. Just to pick up on what will be very brief, what Louise said earlier, we're on a journey, and we're on a journey to improve coverage of sport. And I agree with Catherine that it's not about women doing women's sports and men doing men's sports. It's about covering sport and supporting sport and physical activity for folk to be healthier as well. So I'm just interested in how rugby right now, the Six Nations Women's is on right now, and actually Scottish Rugby doesn't say Scottish Rugby Women or Scottish Rugby Men, it's Scottish Rugby. So would you say that would be a way to support how we convey supporting women in sport, basically, is to take out the issues of gender and just make it Scottish Rugby, for instance, and whatever Six Nations is going on, is that's how we demonstrate and support that?
It's a really interesting question, because we would always liaise with the sporting bodies to just identify the best way to talk about the sport. So my instinct is yes, it's to talk about the sport, but our audience research tells us that people aren't necessarily fans of women's sport, they're fans of a sport. So how do we achieve parity for men and women? We create really fantastic 360 coverage round about a sport. And that's what with our women's football coverage, everything is coming under our sports scene brand. However, we do know from the associations that they really
welcome having a specific women's highlights programme. The games are played at different times, the leagues are different, so that's where we sort of separate things out and we flag up, we have our men's highlights programme and we have our women's highlights programme. Now, that's the way it is at the moment. We would always have a conversation with the sporting bodies and, you know, the organisations about what they prefer. But our coverage of the Women's Six Nations has been fantastic, and I think it's really generated a lot of excitement just under the brand of Six Nations, as you say.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I'm going to move on to our next theme, and I'm going to move to Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. I just was really taken by the comments earlier about the idea of building some sort of ecosystem which could support young women coming into journalism, and I think Mr. O'Gahanny had mentioned previously we'd spoken to women who are participating in sport, perhaps elite athletes, but can't sustain themselves in that sport because it's not got sufficient financial sort of heft yet to actually earn a living out of full time. So I was just wondering, these people who are fans of the sport, are participating in it, probably have great creative, innovative ideas about how to promote it, and just minded to what you said around this local democracy initiative, could this be actually a model perhaps that could support women who are athletes in a sport which is emerging, but also have a potential to promote the sport through journalism as well, and that it's a potential opportunity for the country to look at building something there? Is that something that could be... It's not just in terms of the broadcast. I think broadcasts do an interesting amount of work to bring forward pundits, commentators from the sport with the insights they have, but maybe not so much on the print side. Is this something we could potentially look at building?
I think there's a whole conversation on the finances to be had, and as I said before, I do think that there's a willingness to have it. So, yeah, would be my answer to that, yeah.
That's great. Just a thought I had.
Yeah.
But, yeah, thanks very much, Paul. I think one thing's quite clear from the discussions between the Public Interest Journalism Working Group, which I was on, and the Scottish Government, which is that the direct funding of journalism between government and the organisation is not something that either side would particularly wish to encourage. I think there's an obvious conflict of interest there if there's a direct financial link between those who are holding you to account and you. And I don't think that many of you would support that. What the Local Democracy Reporter Scheme did was create a middleman, if you will. I think that's something which the Public Interest Journalism Group, in proposing a Scottish Public Interest Journalism Institute, was trying to explore with the Scottish Government. And I think that's something which still has legs, but there's no money involved in it just now, and the working group behind it is still trying to find ways in which the institute can be established. But some kind of clearinghouse where support can come in and then be dispersed to those organisations for whatever purpose it may be, whether it's local democracy expansion or coverage of minority sports or coverage of women's sport in general, that would be something which would have legs and a lot of support from our side. But I think it's finding the mechanism that's the point. And I think it's also fair that, you know, we know that the BBC has its own financial challenges just now. And I think, you know, going back to the licence fee concept is probably something which is not tenable either. So there's a lot of work needs doing for this, you know, involving third sector. But very much, I think, finding sustainable ways to enhance quality, trusted coverage is very much what's needed in a whole variety of sectors, not just sport.
Well, I think we'd all lament the sort of decline in, you know, financial capacity within print media over the last few decades. But I think there's a tension there, as described, that you need something that is being pulled on by the reader, you know. But there's then a tension about how do you then put it in front of people if it's not immediate. It's like a chicken and egg scenario, isn't it? Where, you know, to promote curling, for example, it was a huge thing. I remember back in 2002, Salt Lake City Olympic Games, Scotland was crazy for curling for about 6 months. You know, so clearly where it's put in front of people, there is an interest. You know, it's just how do you then seed that demand?
There is a point to be made, though, for sustainable business models for Scottish journalism. It doesn't have to be just the big the big sporting events that yield rewards for us. You can have a very focused audience on a niche sporting topic. I've seen it done at newspapers further up north. The Highland League have gained an awful lot of digital revenue out of being, you know, that newspaper, that brand that is all over it. So it isn't just, oh, we only cover the big ones. You know, niche is actually really good for us if you can get a targeted audience. And there's work for us to do on that, definitely. Some of the women in sport topics do fall into that. But again, there's a little bit more to be to look at the figures at the moment, because they aren't there for us.
The great thing about the digital age is there's no limit to space. You know, in the print era, you were constrained by, you know, where we got 12 pages of sport, and so it's all got to go in there. And there was a competition to occupy that space. So, you know, for example, another sport I know a bit about is hockey, where the participation levels, particularly amongst young women, are massive. I mean, there's over 1,000 young people are playing hockey at Watsonian Hockey Club now every Sunday. So the audience is there. So what's and the space is there to give it quality coverage. What's required is the people in the middle to cover it, and they will and the audience is there to be had. And the cost is the journalism. It's just the journalism, because the production costs are relatively small, but the audiences are there to be had. And at the moment, hockey relies on maybe one or two individuals and Scottish hockey covering its own stuff, which is fine, but it's not the same as going to an independent, trusted platform where you'll get a balance.
There maybe is an opportunity where, you know, there are those people who would love to spend their day writing about their sport as well as participating in the sport, but they don't have the opportunity. Maybe there's a way of joining that up. I just think that's maybe something we can consider. So, thank you.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to all the witnesses. We've heard about what you're doing just now, but do you have targets to invest in future of women's sport and increase coverage? I mean, if your organisations have now set targets to increase the coverage of women's sport.
We don't have targets. BBC Alaba is a partnership that the BBC operates in partnership with MG Alaba, and MG Alaba have been the funders of our television sports portfolio, which has grown over the years, not to a target, but this year we have increased our coverage of the SWPL from 20 games to 26 games. So incrementally, you know, we're growing our commitment to women's sport, but not to a target.
We have not targets, but not specifically for individual sports or forms of sport. But as I mentioned earlier on, we do have targets for diversity and gender balance across our programmes, and we're making good progress towards those targets. And as I said earlier on, they were originally drawn with a view to a 2023 target, and based on the census data that we anticipate, we will review those targets. I think the 50-50 gender target will stay, but the profile of ethnic minorities within our output and within our colleagues' base will change in a new target later this year.
I can answer for BBC Scotland. So our commitment to women's sport is, as I said, it's a long-term commitment, because that allows us to buy good packages of rights and to build audience. So working with BBC Alba, increasing our volume of games for the SWPL, and having active conversation around about, you know, national team performance, and then our commitment to Six Nations women's rugby as well. That's ongoing. But just generally, you know, the big priority for us is round about what we're doing on our streaming platforms and making sure we are achieving 50-50 balance there, and then across our coverage in terms of punditry, commentary. You know, our target really there is to hit that 50-50 and have that talent development piece all leading up to that in terms of representation.
Louise, you mentioned earlier about digital platforms and the diversity of women's sport that you're covering. I'm just wondering if any other witnesses, how could you increase your diversity in sport for women, the coverage of it?
think we have a good coverage of different sports and different areas of sport. I've mentioned a few of them previously. Everything from Lucinda Russell and the Grand National winner appearing on the programme a couple of weeks back, Anastasia Vypan-Law, who's a figure skater from Dundee recently, Emily Nicol, who's a netball centurion now for Glasgow Sirens. So I think we have a range of people and different sports. And I think what is very important for us is not just a gender balance in sport, but also a range of sports from the very established and very popular through to more minority sports that you may not see on TV as much. And when you add in people like Eilish McColgan or Laura Muir, who are very established, I think seeing that range and the people on different parts of their sporting journey, it goes to an earlier question around how can we support people. This is a long-term project that we need to support people. We need to be with them on their journey and their success story, and we need to be making sure that we are reflecting that as part of our daily reporting.
Can I just ask a quick question on that, if you don't mind me jumping in there, David Torrance? So you've mentioned a lot of women's athletes, sports people, throughout your evidence. But are you talking there about featuring them on news articles or within sports packages, but not actually showing their sports?
I think it's both. I think in some cases, wherever we are highlighting the people I've mentioned, which, and I should re-emphasise, this is just from the last few weeks, so this has become very much part of our output, we will report on their performance and their contribution to that sport. And where it's possible, we will use footage, if it's available, from that sport, and we'll reflect the outcome of the competitions that they are in. So I think it's a bit of both. A lot of our news, and it's a very STV editorial style, is based around people. It's about stories that are very people-centric, but of course it's people doing things and where it's to do with sport. This is not just about people through the lens of who they are, although that's important to us, but naturally it does highlight and give presence and promotion to the sport itself.
Yeah, but without actually covering a game, a match or whatever, it's much more a much more focused on that individual.
It is. It's around the sport and the individual, but it is more individual based. That's for sure.
Thank you. David.
Yeah. So what could the Herald or indeed the broader print media be doing to enhance the coverage of women's sport? That was the question, wasn't it? So for us, we're very much on our own journey on what content we cover that is compelling people to pay for a digital subscription. So for us in sport, like the days of covering match reports, you know, or pressers as they were, do nothing for us. They do nothing for us digitally because that's content that's everywhere. You know, every sports journalist was at that event. So for us, it's always looking at a different angle to all of our journalism and sport crossing into news and to business in a way that perhaps sport was seen as this is sport reporting. And we're doing that a lot now, which would come on to the point of how ex-sports people could perhaps come into journalism. Comment pieces and analysis pieces and looking, you know, similarly to the conversation that we're having here, but in our pages, on our website, is the type of stuff that is doing incredibly well for us. So while it may not be, you know, we covered this match, just for example, the wider discussion and the bigger thinking about sports journalism definitely has a place within our content, and it is the type of discussion that we are encouraging with our writers. So we are breaking from traditional sports reporting, I suppose, is in my long-winded way, what I'm trying to say there.
Increasing women's coverage in sport, on whether it's on digital platforms or mainstream media, is it just financial? Because we've heard about restrictions in the licensing fee and the revenue you get from advertising or online people buying. Is it the financial impact that is restricting you covering more women's sport? Or is there any other problems in that area that you face as an organisation?
It's the money, really, it comes down to, because you know, professional journalism costs money, and you know, our organisations could cover as many things as they wanted if they could pay the people to do it. But as revenues go down, then the ability to cover as many things as they can is limited. So it does come down to the finance, and at the other end of it is whether or not it's generating enough revenue at the other end to pay for the staff, and it's always been the case. And the reality is that something like 70% of all new advertising goes to two digital platforms, all going across the Atlantic. And you could expand sports coverage, and it's not going to change that when the vast majority of advertising is going down a programmatic digital platform route. So it's finding ways in which you can guarantee that the finance is there to sustain the coverage and capture the audiences along the way without any real... The incentive is to provide the coverage and to get the audience rather than any real notion that you're going to generate a profit out of it. If it can wash its face, then great.
An issue that's probably particular to broadcast is can be round about the level or indeed existence of a quality feed from the sport, and that can often rely on the investment actually being in the sport itself. So yes, we have a pressure on our budget. We can't do everything. We'll always look for opportunity where we think there's a particular Scottish interest, a Scottish event, something we're doing well at, some exciting talents. We'll always look for an editorial justification for what we invest in, but often it can be a conversation with the organisation to find out if they do indeed have a feed that we can broadcast on our digital platforms.
I've got two other members who want to come in with questions, David, and I'm conscious that we're getting to the end of our time, so I'm going to come to Paul O'Kane and then to yourself, Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. Last week we had a panel of elite athletes in front of us, and we did actually ask them what would they want to put to you as in terms of broadcast and in terms of wider journalism. And I think we've covered quite a deal of that today, but one of the points that was raised by Ailey Doyle was actually about how we refer to women in terms of their careers. She felt quite aggrieved that actually when she turned 30, she was referred to as being at the end of her career, and that she was coming to the end of her kind of life in the sport. And the reality was she'd just won an Olympic medal and went on to play or to run until she was 35. So I think I'm keen to understand perhaps, is there a kind of cognizance of that in journalism more widely about that being quite demoralising, I suppose, and I suppose trying to engage with individuals about their own career and their own progress and try not to make those generalisations?
That's a hangover, I think, because it's not a male-female thing. I think it was generally if you were over 30, then you were getting, over the hill. I certainly know when I played First Division rugby, I was 31 and I felt I was over the hill, and indeed I probably was. I think what's changing as far as athletes are concerned is the level of support in medical understanding, which is lengthening careers. So now you've got people like Johnny Sexton playing for Ireland at the top of his game at 37. And it's not uncommon now to have players of all kinds playing top competitive sport well into the 30s. So the notion about age is changing, that 30 is no longer the benchmark. I mean, now we have across all sports, you've got veterans competitions which are for over 35s. How can you have an over 35 vets competition when people are still able to compete at international level? So I think age is probably something that's changing across the board and not necessarily applicable to females.
I mean, Ailey Doyle would have, I think, contended, and I'll quote verbatim, she said that she was always getting asked when I was retiring how long I was going to go on, and none of my male counterparts were asked those questions. So I think she would feel that it was a very gendered experience in that respect. So I don't know if anyone else wants to add. Catherine?
That some of that is life for a woman, and I can understand what she said there. And there's questions that get asked of female journalists that don't get asked of male journalists. I would say sense checking on all of our content and trying to be professional is how we approach, everything from sport to any, content that we do. But it doesn't surprise me that that over, you know, time, women probably have had a different experience from reporters. But as I say, I think there's a huge cultural shift in journalism, and hopefully that will be reflected.
If I may, Convener, in terms of broadcast was the other issue that we was put to us, I suppose, by those athletes, particularly in terms of we're perhaps more used to, and I think we've heard some of that this morning, seeing, you know, presenters and the talent, if you like, in broadcast being female. But Gemma Fay had put quite starkly to us that very often she didn't feel being as well treated, if you like, as her male counterparts in terms of the research and information that's provided when taking part in a broadcast, where she would have to do a lot of her own research. It was very often provided to the top talent in terms of men. And I think she found that quite a negative experience. And I think she was keen to understand what are you doing in broadcast to try and level that playing field and I suppose, treat talent in the same way across all programmes.
Well, first of all, that's very disappointing to hear, and I'd love to hear more detail from Gemma on that. I would say that what we're doing is we treat everybody equally, and our managers are trained to treat everybody equally. We've talked about inclusion, we've talked about culture. That sounds like not a great example of culture to me, and I would hope that since her experience, things have changed. You know, there are more women in the sports team than ever. There are more women on television and radio than ever, and operating at an extremely high level, the same level as their male counterparts. We look at everybody's pay on a yearly basis. We do fair pay checks. We have rate cards that we apply. And we aim to treat everybody with the same level of professionalism. So yes, disappointed to hear that, but as I say, you know, I think everybody that I know that works in the sport team is absolutely 100% committed to 50-50 inclusive hiring, inclusive managing. So I would probably need to understand a bit more detail on her particular experience to make a more full comment on it.
I think that in our case, we have, again, going to our STV values and our equality ambitions in terms of 50-50 gender balance, not just across the company as a whole, but actually making sure that in the senior parts of our business, we have good representation, both in gender and ethnic minority representation. And I think, again, I think we would pick up very quickly if there was any differentiation. I'm not aware of it in our business. In the way that people approach their roles or indeed are supported in those roles. And I think to a point that went earlier on, if I think about one of our North sport reporters, Stephanie Daly, she and Chris Harvey share the sports reporting duties. Both of them will report on sports featuring both genders. There is no difference in the approach that they take or the support that they have to do those on a day-to-day basis.
Thanks, Convener.
Yes. Thank you, Convener. Building on Paul O'Kane's point about gendered language, so feedback that we received from the elite women athletes was that there is a focus on age and there is a focus when they're being interviewed on are they married. So, and I accept that Catherine said that you do your sense check, which is great, and you're the first female editor in the Herald, so you do your sense check. But if you can't manage what you don't measure, so is there an awareness that there is gendered language, and is it something that you're conscious of, and are you managing it? Thank you. So start off with Bobby, please.
I'm not aware that there is gendered language, and I think that we have a very self-aware team. It's a very professional and experienced team across our newsroom. It's led by Linda Grimes-Douglas, our head of news. And I think that, in general, any clichés or laziness have long been eradicated from what we do by a clear sense of what we're trying to do in be respectful and fair and very purposeful in what we're doing, but not relying on, as I say, clichés and tropes that you'd simply go to over time. So I think we are making
journalism and programmes that are respectful and that do, you know, do not attract that kind of criticism, which again would come across my desk because we have very clear reporting. I think on the sense of the profile of our output, as I've mentioned a couple of times, we're very clear on how that works. We haven't moved to individual stories and language because those are checked thoroughly before transmission on a piece-by-piece basis. So it's not really an area that we measure, but I do agree with the sentiment that if you want to make change, you absolutely have to measure something and set targets in order to do so.
And Convener, may I ask that question to John? Thank you.
Across the industry, there's no measurement of it. But then again, we don't operate in the same kind of tight control, under the same tight controls as the broadcasters do. But I take your point if you can't measure something, it's difficult to know exactly where you are with it. But I mean, I would say that asking questions about people's broader lives should apply to all athletes and not just to females, and that not asking questions of male athletes is a failure as much as anything else. So, but I think that it's something which, as we move forward, requires heightened awareness about making lazy assumptions and stereotyping anybody. It doesn't matter who they are.
Thank you
very much, Tess. Can I thank all the witnesses here this morning for your honest and thorough contributions. I'm sure the committee will find your evidence very helpful when we pull together our report on this inquiry. At our next meeting on the 2nd of May, we'll continue our scrutiny of NHS boards, as well as taking formal evidence as part of our scrutiny of the complex mesh surgical service. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.